Hello everyone. Yeah, thanks Tisha for giving me the opportunity. People call me Rama. I've been here in the Department of Chemical and Biomedical Engineering since August 2005, a long time now. Came here, I did my undergrad in India, then came here for grad school in August 95 to Champaign, Illinois. Then I did a couple of postdocs, went back to Illinois, came here in 2005. So I can tell you a little bit about the work that I am involved in, and also be happy to answer questions. I mean, of course, I don't know what other research is going on in the department as well. So I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have, and also get you in touch with people. Right? I call this topic engineering complex fluids. I mean, I'll tell you a little bit more about my research. I mean, it'll become a little bit clear as we go along, because my goal is to take different kinds of materials, particles, polymers, you know, build them into useful structures, assemble, make useful structures, but at the same time also answer fundamental questions of why and how things happen, right? that's a goal. So I stole this slide from Dr. Ph.D, but I also have an inclusion in here. Dr. Ph.D gave this talk last month, and again, I guess a lot of you are interested in research. Hopefully that's why you're coming to this talk. And why do we encourage our undergraduates into research? I think the research experience, as Dr. Ph.D rightly points out, builds a lot of skills in students, right? It promotes thinking, it instills a lot of problem solving skills, you give presentations, you network, it sometimes, you know, it exposes you to some of the latest technologies and so on. So obviously, but I think the other thing is that I would also like to add is, you know, if you are joining, doing research and you join a team, I think it is, you become a bigger part of the family, right? I think that is very important. It is like you're, I mean, so it's sometimes we get undergraduates in our labs who are in the end of the freshman year, we catch them young. I mean, so they come into the research group, they have other senior undergraduate students who are helping them, who can help them answer questions about, you know, what it takes to progress through the curriculum, say in chemical engineering or whatever department you're in. They talk to graduate students, you know, who do research. So it is like you're part of a big family, right? So I think that support system, the mentoring really helps you out, right? I mean, it's not just research. You can ask any kind of questions, you know, how do I do this class? So sometimes with students in my group, I do spend a lot of time helping them with their coursework, you know, like help sessions, tutoring, mentoring, and so on. So yes, research experience helps, but it's more than just research. It is to, the whole process is to help you do well in undergraduate, right? In the college, so please do seek out professors who are offering these opportunities, right? So I just wanted to mention that. Okay, so going on, I think again, this slide is again taken from Dr. Ph.D's research, Ph.D's, excuse me, presentation. So a lot of these big centers also offer research opportunities. So the FAMU-FSU College of Engineering, I think the one center that they left out was the recent NSF CREST Center on additive manufacturing, which I will tell you a little bit about. So many of the undergraduates, you know, it is very interdisciplinary research, students from a wide variety of disciplines. They use the facilities in a number of these centers that I mentioned. Right. Okay. So moving on. The CREST Center is what we manage.
Excuse me, Dr. Rama.
Uh-huh.
We don't see your screen.
You don't?
No. You have to use the green button in the center and the bottom, share screen.
Oh, you didn't see it from the From the beginning?
No, sir.
Oh, my God. I thought I did.
There you go. Now we can see it.
Oh, this is, okay, let me start from the beginning. So I can quickly go through. So you should have told me. So, okay, I thought I was, Bobby, you didn't even tell me. So, okay, so this was the second slide. I was talking about why do we encourage our students into research, right? The slide from Dr. Pamidi. This is about the different centers. That's a map, I guess, where the different centers are put. I mean, people know this all right next to each other. So, and I was just telling you about the NSF CREST Center, so which we manage, which is actually from three different, quite a few different departments. So the goal is, it's a nice center that we have on based on materials research. The goal is, suddenly on screen popped up. So the idea is on additive manufacturing. Many of you know what 3D printing is. And why is 3D printing important, right? We are working closely with the Department of Defense, the Air Force, and the Army. Let's say your station, say in the Middle East somewhere, but then suddenly, you have an equipment, the tool breaks, what do you do? So obviously you have to get it from mainland US, but then the number one preference is health, food, safety, all these issues. And then it's going to be a long time before you get a replacement part, say, right? Or let's say you're on Mars and then suddenly you need to build something. How do you do that, right? So additive manufacturing is gaining a lot of interest in recent years. But then it's not just additive manufacturing, right? In the sense, obviously you got to print materials. So if you're going to print some novel devices and structures, you got to focus on synthesizing novel materials. You got to characterize them. Then you got to develop novel schemes of, maybe using robots to print it, multi-material printing. So many issues, right? And not only that, so many fundamental physics questions of why and how things happen also come into play, right? For this particular research, we want students from a wide variety of disciplines, chemistry, physics, engineering, and so on. And the center, it has three big aims. The first aim is when you can use an applied flow and field, such as magnetic fields, to process materials, to build strong composites. The sub-project two involves energy-related devices, solar cells, batteries, developing novel conductive polymers, and then printing them. The third project, we are working with FAMU Pharmacy and as well as FSU College of Medicine, where we are trying to do all kinds of bioprinting, lab on a chip, systems on a chip. We have some excellent collaborators with Harvard Medical School, whom we are trying to work with on these projects. This slide also illustrates the through joint nature of the college, in the sense that even though we got this grant through Florida A&M University, a number of students from both FAMU and FSU are being involved in this research. We would love to have more students involved from across the two campuses. Actually, I was just talking earlier on in this day to an FSU student, Megan, who wants to do an honors thesis in sub-project two, where we are trying to develop some novel materials for energy-related research, right? So that's the CREST mission of the CREST Center. Okay, so now so research is very tightly integrated with education. So obviously we need to produce PhD candidates, which we have in the CREST Center. But then we also have a number of undergraduate students working with us. We run REUs over summer. I'll tell you a little bit more about all the activities that we have in the CREST Center. I shouldn't turn off pop-ups, I guess. Give me one second. So, right. And then we have a number of training opportunities as well. We send them out for internships, summer research experiences, and so on. I will tell you a little bit more about all the education activities that we are doing in the center, which we offer to our undergraduates, right? And again, I mean, just to give you before an introduction to the projects in the center, I mean, I would like to, I always like the slide because I mean, it tells you why I call it engineering complex fluids or colloidal suspensions, right? I mean, just to give you an introduction of the kind of problems that we are dealing with, this is a classic experiment that was done a long time ago by Lord Rayleigh, where he's shown a laser through a couple of beakers, right? This is just pure water, and this is the water with colloidal particles, or you can call it complex fluids. So as you can see, I mean, you can't see the laser going through water, while you can see this red light beam that goes through the this particular beaker. Why? This is because, you know, you have a bunch of particles that are floating around and diffusing around is the right term. And when it comes in the path of the laser, it refracts, it reflects the light, and you can see the red light going through. I mean, think about this, right? These particles can be any kind, can be proteins, polymers, can be silica, alumina, ceramic, you know, any kind of thing. And as you can see, you know, when you're talking of a certain application, right, you need to process these materials, right? You need to synthesize them, you need to disperse them, but then you need to pump them, you need to flow them. And then you need for a certain application, right? So that's why I call this engineering complex fluids, because say you need to take such a suspension, you need to 3D print them for say a certain application. It can be a solar cell, can be an organ on a chip, it can be a bunch of different applications, right? So that's what we do in the center, right? I mean, we synthesize, we characterize, we process and a wide variety of materials, right? Some of the projects that we have been involved in our group, a long time ago, we did deal with shear. This is what is known as shear thickening fluids. So, you know, lightweight armor. So if a missile strikes a target, you know, it goes through if there is no protection. But they are what are known as shear thickening fluids. The missile strikes the target. Locally, the shear rate is so high that you know, it looks like a solid, right? So which acts like a bulletproof vest. Obviously, we are doing a lot of 3D printing. This is a picture taken from a very famous scientist, Jennifer Lewis, where you have all these printers, you know, with which you can print all kinds of novel materials, devices. But then when you think of a printer, I mean, it's a classic chemical engineering or a mechanical engineering fluid mechanics problem. You know, you have thin tubes through which you need to pump concentrated suspensions, gels, and then it has to come out from a very small nozzle. So what controls the flow properties of these suspensions? How can you build multi-layer structures? I mean, you can answer all kinds of questions, fundamental questions as well. So I did teach a course in, when was this? Spring 2020, Bobby? Where on 3D printing, and we had a lot of fun. One final project was on chocolate 3D printing. So what happened was students were very happy, but then I guess they weren't very happy when they had to realize that they had to solve non-Newtonian fluid mechanics and flow of complex materials. But chocolate is extremely interesting material to study. I mean, it has so many crystalline forms, and how you manipulate temperature determines what crystalline form you get, and hence the taste. I mean, it was a very interesting project. So all kinds of materials, right? We were trying to take sugarcane residues, which is very prevalent in Florida, trying to break it down so that you could get glucose and cellulose, which you can then feed to bacteria to produce fuel. We were using particles to form membranes, and by controlling how particles pack, you could control the pore size of the membrane, which you could use for different applications. Lots of cool projects. So Bob, okay, so I went one slide too much. This was Bobby's project. Bobby, who just graduated, did his PhD here. And he, can I play this video, Bobby? He worked, actually joint project with the Harvard School of Engineering and Applied Science. He was using this very novel microfluidic device to make particles. And the thing is, the cool thing about these particles is they are, these are what is known as Janus particles. I mean, as you can see, two distinct chemical identities on each side, right? The red is a certain chemistry, the gray here has a certain chemistry. I mean, he can make these novel particles, which can be used for a number of applications. Runisha actually is, I have a talk from Runisha which I can put up after this, which is coming. I mean, so we are working jointly with the Air Force, where we are using cellulose as a reinforcement for composites. And we are 3D printing these composites in collaboration with the Air Force. And not only that, I think we are developing some novel experimental techniques at the national labs, at Brookhaven National Lab in upstate New York, where we can use simultaneous X-ray scattering and 3D printing to determine how the cellulose particles are organized in the resin. I mean, basically the structure of the cellulose particles in the resin determines its final properties. And the question is, how does flow influence the structure and so on and so forth? So a lot of very applied work, and also there's a lot of fundamental science in it as well. And not only that, we are also stepping back from a very fundamental point of view. What do you mean by a gel, right? What happens in a gel? What controls the flow properties of a gel, right? What makes a material flow, right? How hard do you have to pump it to make it flow, right? You can answer such questions using a combination of both theory and experiments. Divya just graduated with a PhD from FSU. She is working in Johnson & Johnson and trying to make new drugs right now, actually. So lots of interesting projects. We are working with FAMU Pharmacy, where Mandeep Singh, he is developing, is doing all kinds of bioprinting for breast cancer. I mean, he's printing all kinds of scaffolds with breast cancer cells, trying to test new drugs on them. I mean, all kinds of very interesting science. Tariq is an industrial engineering. He is working on 3D printing dye-sensitized solar cells. He has this really cool chemistry polymers, which are really conductive. But then the challenge is, how do you make a thin conducting wire of these materials, right? What kind of printing scheme do you adopt? And things like that. And not only that, I think he has a lot of other interesting research in 3D printing too. He has multiple robotic arms trying to print the same material, but then it's a complex case of how do you schedule them, what path do they follow, and so on and so forth. And then he's using a lot of AI machine learning for his 3D printing research also. So. Lots of cool topics related to materials. Give me one second. How do I stop this? So what I'm going to show you is also Ronisha has. How long is this talk, Ronisha? A couple of minutes. Okay, so that's not too bad. So Ronisha gave the who's a PhD student in my group. She joined from Clemson, and this is a joint project with the Air Force. But then she was also invited by Dow. Well, a number of undergraduates also got this opportunity in the previous years. So this is a very nice opportunity. So she gave a talk at the Dow Symposium. Obviously, all of this is online. This is related to her research at the Air Force. So,
engineers are always looking to create stronger, lighter, and more durable products. Throughout history, our most significant technological advancements occur as a result of new materials becoming available.
Does it automatically
go to the next slide? Through my PhD work, I plan to contribute to the innovation of new products. My project has allowed me to combine both applied and fundamental research by coupling a youthful and modern processing technique with the classic understanding of structure-function relationships within highly loaded composite materials. In the future, the materials that I work with could be used as thermal management devices to reduce buildup of heat in your iPhone, or structures on an airplane to make the trip faster and more affordable. In addition to material selection, a critical component of my work lies in the manufacturing process of the composites. I develop design rules for utilizing these composite materials in additive manufacturing and show quantitative proof of improved performance. We do this by carrying out three main experimental steps. Rheological techniques allows us to understand the viscoelastic properties and the printability of the material. Several X-ray scattering techniques allows us to assess the structure of the material before, during, and after the printing process. And finally, we adjust different printing parameters to test the performance of the composite. In my recently submitted work, we utilized highly loaded graphene nanoplatelet-based composites to build electrically and thermally conductive structures. We demonstrate first the ability of the material to be used in extrusion. We then adjust printing parameters and monitor how the structure changes its function and nozzle speed and scattering techniques. Overall, we show that we can increase our electrical performance by order of magnitude by simply increasing nozzle speed from 5 to 40 millimeters per second. This increased shear changes the overall structure of the particles as shown in the scattering results, and this change in alignment then results in enhanced performance. The range of applications for polymer-based composites still lacks competitive metals. However, I feel confident that the content that I have built on over the past 4 years will shed light on the potential of both composite materials and the use of additive manufacturing on a larger scale. Thank you.
So nice, right? So that was Ronisha, and of course, I mean, we have undergraduate students in a lab too who get such opportunities, whom Dow is very interested in hiring and in recruiting. So in terms of facilities, most of our printers are in HPMI, the High Performance Materials Institute. We have like three state-of-the-art 3D printers. We have a metal printer. There's going to be a nice big glove box being installed right now, and an FSU honor student is going to start working on that. Excellent facilities, and not only that, I can give you a tour of the lab too. I guess I can do that. The cool thing is, I mean, you'll have access to a number of these center facilities as well, the HPMI, AME, MagLab. My lab is in the MagLab where I'm talking from right now. So far characterizing a lot of materials, and of course we go to the national labs as well to perform experiments. We have excellent collaborators. EPA is an educational partnership agreement with the Air Force Research Lab. CREDA is another some kind of joint agreement, but with the Army Research Labs, that's ARL. Harvard, MIT, Argonne, College of Medicine. And also our undergraduates, we give them an opportunity through the center to spend time at our collaborators' institutions as well. Like over summer, we do have funds where we can send undergrads over to Army or the Air Force or to Harvard. I mean, a lot of our undergrads, I mean, quite a few of them have gone on to Harvard, worked with Bobby on research projects over summer. So I personally have taken students, I was taking two undergraduates to national labs every year for like 3 years working on experiments. My collaborator at the MIT is the one, we are still looking for students who want to do this next year as well, if the situation permits, right? So if you're doing research, obviously you will be exposed to such opportunities for sure, right? Depending on your interests, of course. A lot of students have gone to Dow, Johnson & Johnson, Lockheed Martin, Boeing. We also have an RDU where you could also spend time working on research with us. The kind of things that we do while you're working on research with us, we help you apply for fellowships, all kinds of national fellowships. We encourage all our students to go to conferences and present. So this picture here is at the every May, unfortunately we couldn't do this. I would encourage you to get involved. We have started the ACS, American Chemical Society Polymer Material Science and Engineering Program, the group in Tallahassee. So every May, there is near Clearwater Beach. We have this conference and we take both undergraduate, graduate students. They present posters, talks. We run a symposium. And we also, we run a workshop on 3D printing, which all of our students are involved in. So a lot of students have gone on being successful after their graduation. Many go to industry, many go to graduate school. And actually this fall, four of our students will be joining our graduate school. Not only that, while when you're in an REU over summer with us, we help you with applications to graduate school. We also have GRE prep, which you can take while you're doing your research. We run a lot of things too. I mean, we run a GEM grad day. GEM is an organization where you can apply for fellowships. Some of our students have gotten GEM fellowships. There's a very nice session that we ran at the, it's a beautiful location. It's a Innisbrook resort near Clearwater Beach. I mean, it's, and not only, I mean, we run the session, there are a lot of high profile invited speakers from the Army, Air Force, from companies who came down for the manufacturing session. Again, we have started the Polymer Material Science and Engineering Division, ACS, here in Tallahassee. So Ronisha was the founding president. So we are looking for someone else to take over right now. We have a lot of activities too, which I know are research related. I mean, I think this was the founding group some time ago. Actually we are holding another big workshop. Hopefully, we couldn't hold this fall, unfortunately. This was being planned. Dauf actually played a big part in funding this workshop partially, where we got a huge group of students, undergraduates, graduate students. A lot of people came down from industry as well to help us run this workshop, right? And the main aim was to encourage more undergraduates to go into graduate school, hopefully, which did happen actually. So those are all the slides that I have. I don't know, maybe you want me to go around the lab? Do you want to show some of the equipment that we have? Oh, really, Tisha, can you help Bobby? Or should I just use this? Really? How do I stop sharing? Bobby Haney has entered.
I let him back in. Now I have to make him co-host. Hold on. There you go. Okay, Bobby, you should be good.
Okay, I can walk around the
way. You're sure. So some of the instruments, classic chemical engineering, fluid mechanics, Ronisha is actually running an experiment. This is what is known as a rheometer, which is used to measure the flow properties of suspension. Say if you go work in Procter & Gamble or say Colgate Palmolive, right?
Toothpaste is a $1 billion industry. So this measures the flow properties of suspensions. Give me one second.
I've muted everything.
So this measures the you need to characterize how things flow. It can measure what is known as the viscosity, the elasticity. Think about this, right? Toothpaste, it's in a tube, you squeeze on it, it has to come out, but as soon as you get it on your toothpaste, it has to regain its elasticity, right? There's similar things when you're trying to 3D print structures. So the black stuff that you see here is graphene, which is a very conductive material, and you can print all kinds of novel electronic structures with graphene, which is what we are trying to do. So we measure the flow properties. This machine here is, is a light scattering instrument, which you can use to measure sizes of particles. You can measure down to a couple of nanometers. You can even measure the sizes of proteins. So you put your this in a tube, and then you can stick it into the machine, and then think about this, right? Isn't that mind-boggling? How can you measure something that's 2 nanometers, right? Wow, right? I think that's pretty cool itself, how the machine can do that. Classic chemistry lab. The characterization. So this is what is known as a HPLC, but it's hooked up to all kinds of light scattering detectors. Trust me, this gig costs nearly $400,000 or something to set up, but like we got lucky with the Department of Defense grant. So it is actually, if you make novel particles, polymers, you need to characterize them, right? Polymer is like a spaghetti chain. In the sense that how long is the chain? Is it branched? What is the chemistry? How do you characterize it? How easily does it flow? And these machines can do that. It's actually, we have graduate students and undergrads trying to characterize novel materials. We are setting up a bunch of different things, as you can see. It's kind of a little bit of a messy lab we're trying to clean up. I guess I can stop at that.
Dr. Rama, this is at the mag lab, right?
Yes, this is at the mag lab.
Gotcha.
I'll stop here and I can, answer questions.
Okay, if you all have a question, type it in the chat.
I lost voice.
And we'll make sure. I'll make sure
because
that.
I muted myself.
Hey, Dr. Rama, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, so we have one question from Ednell. Would you be able to theoretically measure a cell or the linings, or maybe even cancer cells as they grow?
So that's a bio question. I think right at the mag lab now. My colleague, Jamal Ali, who's a new faculty, we are working with him on bioprinting, and we have a couple of small bioprinters in his lab. And that is what some of my, Bobby and Tyler are working on, printing breast cancer cells into some scaffolds and trying to image them as they grow. Yes, he has some complicated microscope setup with which he's trying to do that. So I don't know the details yet. I don't know what you mean by theoretically measure. You would experimentally measure something, I guess. That's what we're trying to do. Yes, actually, right now he's trying to do those experiments. We wish we could let you into the lab to see what they're doing, but unfortunately, it's not possible now.
Okay. We have a question from Luciana. Can a junior chemical engineering undergrad without previous lab experience apply for research in the fall, Dr. Rama?
Sure, of course. As I told you, right, I think it is, yes, we want you to do good science and have an interest in science, be committed and do the work. But at the same time, it's an experience. So it is to help you to realize what you like doing, what you don't like doing, and to, you know what I'm saying, and to help you do well in the curriculum. So that's the main point. Yes, of course. We don't expect people to be researchers when they come in. For sure.
Okay. Nina has a question. Are there opportunities for research involvement as a rising sophomore who is part of UROP at FSU?
Yes. I'm telling you, we usually try to catch students even in their freshman year. Towards the end of the freshman year. Yes. For sure, yes. With the hope that you would stick with us for 3 years. We try to tell them certain things too, right? The earlier you start, the better. because say you want to apply for a national, prestigious national fellowship, say like the NSF GRFP or the DOD has a Department of Defense has a bunch of fellowships too, right? And these are very nationally competitive, right? So how do you make yourself more competitive, right? I mean, you ask yourself the question, and one way to do that is to publish some papers, right? But papers don't drop out of trees, right? I mean, it requires a lot of work, years of work. But if you start early, say in your sophomore year, and then you work with a grad student or a postdoc, you get some good results, you publish them, you're part of a publication. I'm not saying you be the lead, but if you're part of a publication, then that really improves your chances. So the earlier you start, much better it is. For sure, we involve sophomores, juniors in our research, yeah.
Okay, let's see, Dr. Haney, would you speak a little bit about your experience and maybe your undergraduate and grad experience? I know you just got your PhD recently and are headed to Harvard for a postdoc.
Right, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, great. Okay, yeah, so hi everyone. I'm Bobby Haney. So my undergrad was in applied mathematics. It was at a school in South Carolina called Claflin University. And then I did another bachelor's in chemical engineering at Clemson University. And then I decided to grad school here at Florida A&M with Dr. Rama. I met him at a conference. Well, I talked to him at a conference. And he told me about all the things he pretty much told you guys. And made it sound pretty. And so I decided to come also. And so since I've been here, of course, we got started as soon as I came with research. I was doing projects from kind of synthesizing or polymerizing styrene from the surface of nanoparticles, then cellulose. I was making flexible electronics from cellulose. And then I did the project he just told you guys about the Janus particles that were used to make these mixtures of oil and water. And my experience through the entire time I was here is about 5 years. Was just learning how to be a research scientist, learning how to read research articles, which, believe it or not, was probably the most powerful part of the entire scientific method. You can't really move forward, you move forward faster when you know what others have done, know what doesn't work and what does work, and it allows you to know what to buy, what materials to use, and how to actually address whatever scientific question you're trying to figure out. So I learned a lot about, I got a lot of mentorship about how to think scientifically and actually form stories or whatever work, whatever projects or work I might be working on. And also, of course, I had many different classmates to talk to. Their projects were completely different from mine. So I was able to experience or see different types of research here. And of course, as Rama mentioned, he also sent me to Harvard University to do a lot of my research, where the same thing happened there. I had exposure to other scientists. I know other students in the lab Rama has sent to the Army lab as well as the Air Force lab. So a lot of things happened just being a student here in definitely Rama's lab. As far as getting your work done, if he doesn't know the answer, which happens quite a bit, he definitely will find someone who can possibly help you with getting that answer. I think this the best part of this lab is we find a way to make sure you can move forward with any project that you might be working on, because we know people in small places, high places that can actually contribute to whatever ideas you may have. And we figure things out, and that's what science is all about. You hit a wall, you figure out how to go around it, or you at least in the end, you at least know what to do next, so you figure out the question. So yeah, and of course, through these collaborations with Harvard, after I graduated, I wanted to do a postdoc degree to actually build a resume to be an actual professor, and Harvard definitely offered that I could come there and work as a postdoc on on a different project. Most likely when I get there, I'm going to be working on something more bio-related. I'm going to be working on something more bio-related. And then and possibly maybe some other things. I'm not sure yet. But mostly, to tell you a little bit about the bio-related work, I'm going to be working on it. You can imagine if the connection, the way the bone connects to the muscle, in between is a transition. Of course, bone cells are a lot harder than muscle cells, but they still touch, they connect. There's an interface, if you will, there. So if some kind of muscle is torn or anything torn, any ligaments, how do cells repair themselves? Or what are the physics there, bio-related physics there that allows the cells to heal themselves? And also, can we create that with 3D printing? Can we engineer that cellular environment, that bone to transition to muscle, cellular environment, and kind of just probe how well those things grow back together? That's all. But I know there's a lot of questions, but I did see a question that asked me what my research was. I saw a lot of questions, actually. Should I wait? You want to ask the questions? I'm finished talking.
I'll ask them. So you may have talked about this, but what kind of research have you been doing? And are you looking into accelerating cell reparation? It looks like the repairing of cells.
Oh, repairing cells?
Yeah.
Okay, what kind of research am I doing? So first I'm gonna answer what kind of research I was doing here, and then what I'm moving for, because they're different. Research here was involved with emulsions or mixtures of oils and water. For example, milk is an emulsion of oil and water. It's mostly water with fatty oil droplets suspended. That's why it looks white or just not transparent. As the emulsion droplets coalesce, as that happens, you might see a phase separation of the milk goes bad. So this is an example of emulsion. But what prevents droplets from becoming larger? That was what was going on. When I was a graduate student, I started those particles or those side of were made to when they're added to water, they occupy right there at the interface of a droplet. So you got these millions of droplets. And if you get a particle that sits right there on the surface of the droplets, as the droplets come into contact with each other, the particles, because they're covering the droplet, it prevents them from coalescing or makes the milk last longer. It wasn't necessarily milk. Sometimes it's cosmetics, perfumes, colognes. My biggest idea for application was oil spill cleanup, but as many things you can do with the particles. So that's what I was working on here, just making these particles that can control or make emulsions more stable. Going forward, as I was talking about the cellular work, I think you said cell repairing. So anyway, cells, in a sense I am, but more so what I'm looking at is I was talking about the transition from the bone to the muscle and the interface between the two. What I'm doing is engineering tissue. They call them biomimetic scaffolds. I'm engineering, literally, I'm designing fake tissue that cells will actually thrive in, that actually stick to, that actually grow in. And as they sit in this environment that I create, they'll destroy that environment and build their own environment that's similar to what I engineer. So I'm going to create an area on the left. On one side of this tissue I create, I'm going to make one area that looks like bone. I'm going to make a second area that looks like the transition between bone to muscle. And then a third area that looks like the muscle environment that muscle tissue cells will sit in. Once I create this environment, I'm going to put the actual cells inside. I'm going to put the actual bone cells, muscle cells inside, and they should form a connected network of bone and tissue that resembles what I created, which in a sense creates the bone and tissue connection point. So that's my past research and then the research moving forward.
Okay, thank you, Bobby. Let's see, Dr. Rama, a couple questions that I think are best for you to answer. First of all, would you still recommend undergrad research to students who are not sure about grad school or maybe interested in working in industry?
Yes, because it helps you find out, right? I mean, it helps you find out which way you want to go. So yeah, for sure, no problem. There's absolutely no problem in people and doing that, because it helps you find out where you want to go. But sometimes the issues that we have faced in the such instances is maybe not sign up for something like an honors thesis or an undergraduate thesis project, because in the middle of it, you don't want to realize that. Even though you realize you want to go to industry, suppose you're doing research, my only advice is still stay committed to the work that you are doing and still do a good job, right? I think that is important. So just keep that in mind. Absolutely no problem. Yeah, I mean, a lot of our students, not many go on to graduate school. Many of them go to industry.
Okay. Let's see. And then how Edna wants to know how research is being affected by the COVID situation. Are undergrads able to actively contribute in labs, or are some things continue to be restricted, and how's that going to change for fall, or do we even know yet? Because I know a lot of things change daily about fall.
I certainly hope students are allowed, at least the ones who have signed up to do research, but currently the answer is no. But of course, I mean, it might change in the fall, so we just have to wait and see. So unfortunately, that's the answer I can give.
Okay, and I know Dr. Pamidi said over on the electrical side, they're doing some things with Zoom to allow people to do UROP projects and undergrads doing some lab work. So I think departments are being really creative about that, Ednell, to try to keep everyone involved. Hopefully this will resolve soon.
Correct, yes.
Yeah.
So it depends on the white work that you do. Maybe sometimes if you're doing some theoretical computational work, you can still be involved. Maybe, hopefully in the next few months, if you want to be involved, you can work with someone doing some theoretical work, and then you can transition into the lab in the next 2-3 months, hopefully.
Okay. Abby wants to know, what would you say is the best way to get involved in a particular research group, and are there any processes such as interviews that you have to go through to get involved?
So let me say this, Abby. So don't make this too formal. At least it is very informal. So please don't feel afraid to approach professors. So it's just a casual chat. We don't expect you to be a superstar researcher or someone who knows everything and things like that. It's very casual. So go approach professors, just chat with them. It's a matter of getting to know you, what you like to do and what you want to do. So there's nothing like a formal interview or something like that, which at least I follow. So it is more getting to know you, what your interests are, and what you want to do, right? And trying to understand if, your interests fit into what I am doing in my lab, right? So that is more important. So talk to professors. This is not a very formal thing. It is very informal. So we would like to know what you want to do, what your goals are, and where you want to go with this, right? And just trying to understand you better. There is no such formal interview and things like that. It's very informal and a casual chat. Sometimes you come to our group meetings. If you want, you can look at what research we are doing. You can talk to our other undergraduates, graduate students, and so on. And then you can make a decision. It is very informal. So just go talk to the professors whom you think you're interested in. And I bet they're more than willing to help you out.
Okay. We only have one more question that I can see. So I'm going to ask that question, but I'm also going to screen share, because I have some links and information that you all will like that tells where to find these research opportunities. So while Dr. Rama is answering this question, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. Hold on just a second. And then you guys can put this, write these things down. There you go. Okay, Dr. Rama, can you see my screen?
Uh-huh.
Okay, good. So here's information about FSU undergraduates. There's several programs, FAMU undergraduates, there's the CREST program, which actually carries all the way through grad school, I believe. And then all engineering undergraduates, there's some opportunities for you there. And please note that you don't have to stay in your major. You can, but you also can work in another professor, maybe mechanical engineering or something like that. Dr. Rama, the last question that we have is, are there FAMU-FSU chemical engineering professors that serve as research sponsors for the FSU UROP program?
Oh, yes, a lot of them, yes. Even I was one, I'm still one, I think.
excuse me, yes.
100%. So you can, the best way, okay, how do you want to, as Tisha rightly said, if you have questions, you can come talk to me, send me an email. You can easily look me up. You can also go and talk to the chair and regarding your interests. Look up any particular professor whom you're interested in. You can directly email the professors. I'm sure that they will respond. That is it. We are very happy to talk to undergraduate students and keep them involved in research. And as I think as Tisha mentioned in the chat, I taught Megan last year. In a junior year. I teach transport phenomena. I don't know how many of you are going to be in my class starting fall. Megan came up and asked me about, he's an FSU undergrad, she said she was interested in novel chemistries and for energy-related applications and things like that. And then we got her involved in the novel 2D material called MXT. We just got, we just purchased a $40,000 glove box, which we have to process these materials in a very oxygen-free environment so that it doesn't oxidize. She is going to help a graduate student and a postdoc, and we're going to work together as a team on it. As Tisha says, don't just be dependent on the Europe. I think, as I said, this is not a very formal process. It's very informal. We want to help you move forward, right? Not just in research, but also in trying to understand what you want to do in your life, right? I think that's important. We are more than happy to talk to students. We reply to your emails. Go out and talk to your different professors. You can chat with them about anything, right? It's not formal. So just chat with them with any questions that you have. We're more than happy to answer them.
Okay, I'm going to put in the chat, it doesn't look like there's any other questions. I'm going to put Dr. Rama's email in the chat, so you can get in touch if you want to. Okay, and remember, he's a CBE professor, but he's a nice guy, and he's friends with everybody around the college, so he probably knows what people are doing in other departments, too. So if you have any questions about anything, you can either let me know via email or Dr. Rama. All right. I think that's it, Dr. Rama and Dr. Haney. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right. Have a good day.
Thanks, Tisha.